WBAI New York and WBAI.org. Our next scheduled program will be the War on Immigrants Report. Please stay tuned.
Fireworks over, folks. Fireworks over. Move along. Nothing to see. Nothing to see, silly. This is radio. Nothing to see? Tell that to the NSA. But no, this is not total information awareness. This is the War on Immigrants Report, a monthly installment of Global Movement's Urban Struggles Collective on WBAI Radio. Happy birthday, America. Let's throw a handful of air quotes to indicate irony. Happy birthday to the land of the free and home of the brave. We better be brave, since we're not exactly free. In the Times, well, first in the Huffington Post, there is a report that the final version of the Senate immigration bill that passed last week will add a $38 billion amount to the price tag of the bill with the Corker-Hoven amendment that may reduce the flow of illegal immigrants, quote-unquote, however, vastly militarizes the border. Several groups have already made their opinion known that this was a trade-off that substantially not only has an enormous price tag, but has a terrible impact. I think the military took over Egypt, but, you know, they're taking over this bill as well. A recent report from the Congressional Budget Office indicated significant savings from the immigration reform bill, the CBO, estimated previously that the legislation would reduce the deficit by $700 billion over the next 20 years, while its final version would shrink the deficit by $685 billion in the same time period. Over the first decade, the bill passed last week would reduce the deficit by $158 billion and cost $23 billion to implement. However, the final cost of the bill, with all the Gang of Eight additions, the militarization, the drones, the walls, would be a final cost of $298 billion over the next decade. So, happy birthday, land of the free. Land of the free reminds me of a Langston Hughes poem, and I wanted to ask Sydney if he could jump right in. It's America Never Was America to Me.
Oh, could you hand? Can I borrow your reading glasses?
Oh, yes, sure.
Yeah. Yeah, so we're all of an age here. All righty. So, Langston Hughes. I am the young man, full of strength and hope, tangled in that ancient, endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, of grab the goal, grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's greed. I am the farmer, the bondsman, up to the soil. I am the worker, sold to the machine. I am the Negro, servant to you all. I am the people, humble, hungry, mean. Hungry yet today, despite the dream, beaten yet today. Oh, pioneers, I am the man who never got ahead, the poorest worker, battered through the years. Yet I am the one who dreamt our basic dream in the old world while still a serf of kings, who dreamt a dream so strong, so brave, so true, that even yet its mighty daring sings in every brick and stone, in every furrow turned that made America the land it has become. Oh, I am the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I am the one who left the dark Ireland's shore and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea, and torn from Africa's strand I came to build a homeland free. The free? Who said free? Not me, surely not me. The millions on relief today? The millions shot down when we strike, the millions who have nothing for our pay, for all the dreams we've dreamed, all the songs we've sung, all the hopes we've held, and all the flags we've hung, the millions who have nothing for our pay, except the dream that's almost dead today.
Oh yes, I say it plain, America never was America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be.
Oh, your glasses. Yes, all at right. WBAI, we share one set of glasses for the entire staff.
Omid Safi, a colleague of mine, added this today in Facebook. Yes, when there is Guantanamo Bay and drone attacks, America was never America to me. When we have tens of millions without health care, America was never America to me. When we have half our children at or below the poverty line, America was never America to me. When we spend more on our military than the next 12 countries combined, America was never America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be. Somewhere between the hot dogs and the burgers today is our resolute promise to make America be America to all. So the NSA has been spying on all phone calls, and that doesn't sound very much like the land of the free. And in the front page of today's Times, there is also an article. Postal Service is watching, too. Outside of all mail is recorded. An article by Ron Nixon. Apparently, the National Security Agency is not only spying on all our phone exchanges, but the Postal Service has joined in. This is a longtime surveillance system called mail covers, which has led to a vastly more expansive effort, the Mail Isolation Control and Tracking Program, in which Postal Service computers photograph the exterior of every piece of paper mail that is processed in the United States, about 160 billion pieces last year. It is not known how long the government saves the images. And it shows that this is where we've come to. Regarding immigration, reading on in the article, it mentions that this program has already led to sporadic reports of abuse. In May 2012, Mary Rose Wilcox, a Maricopa County supervisor in Arizona, was awarded nearly $1 million by a federal judge after winning a lawsuit against Sheriff Joe Arpaio. The sheriff, the infamous Sheriff Arpaio, known for his immigration raids, had obtained mail covers from the Postal Service to track her mail. The judge called the investigation into Mrs. Wilcox politically motivated because she had been a frequent critic of Mr. Arpaio's, objecting to what she considered the targeting of Hispanics in his immigration sweeps. So, again, onward we march. It's enough to make me want to use some expletives here, but the government bans mention of, synonyms of urination, intercourse, twat, and weenie. Instead of going after sin, the law targets synonyms. Maybe it's better for the state to criminalize grammatical structures and fashion taboos in this primitive way. Of course, it doesn't stop there. This holiday does not celebrate a memo or a piece of paperwork or wordsmithing, but rather the spirit of freedom behind it. And now the spirit is wavering and trembling as it's attacked in all directions. Which brings us back to the NSA and to the other report in the Times today that the U.S. Border Agency is allowing other law enforcement groups to use its drones, apparently for investigating phishing violations and other uses. So there's no doubt more information to find out about that. One good bit of good news I can think of course, is last week the City Council of New York did pass the CSA bill, which was including one bill designed to roll back stop and frisk, and another to institute IG or the Inspector General over the NYPD. And this is actually really great. The numbers of supporters in the council should be enough to overcome expected veto by the mayor. The mayor and the commissioner are working very hard, and now joined by the PBA, the Patrolman's Benevolent, they are flyering Queens and really exerting a lot of pressure. And if you want to jump in and help put the pushback against this, because they're trying to turn the votes, I would suggest contacting Drum. Daisy's rising up and moving as they're coordinating some of the response to keep our police accountable. And Daisy's rising up and moving is at 718-205-3036. Now, we're going to play a bit of music in just a second, then we'll be having guests on, mainly focused in on refugee policy and refugee crises. There are many types of immigrants, obviously, and they're not all that popular. Even the Dreamers who were brought here, not in chains, but not by choice either, but as children, have still not fully gotten their rights in Nebraska and in Arizona. They are voting to refuse them driver's licenses. Again, this is a process, but the welcome that we show refugees from the beginning of our country is something that we should examine and celebrate, perhaps today, 4th of July, that we don't betray that contract with the oppressed. So we'll just put on some music.
What are your names?
Sebastian.
Cesario.
Sebastian and Cesario. You look familiar. Where do you come from?
We come from the land of betrayal. An Indian word meaning hate. But the people smile all the time there, and the cultural advantages are great. The air that we breathe is polluted. The wars that we fight are the same. But no one is quite sure who leads us, so no one is ever to blame. Our principal export is lying. Truth, youth, and beauty we ban. Our principal pastime is loving the kind they stamp made in Japan. I must say you do look familiar. Could it be that you've ever been there? We live in the heart of the city where deceit double crosses despair.
And this is Adam Carroll again from WBAI's War on Immigrants report. And that was a little something from two gentlemen of Verona, which dates me. But it's a wonderful show. This 4th of July, we're remembering freedom. Not only the freedom to live in privacy and dignity, far from spying, far from stop and frisk, but we're considering the tradition of giving sanctuary and safe haven for those fleeing oppression. Are there fewer refugees being resettled? What are the trends in refugee assistance, and what are the obstacles to resettlement? Our guest is Mitzi Schroeder, Director for Policy at Jesuit Refugee Service USA, who has been working since 1979 to defend the rights of refugees and migrants throughout the world. She's also served as Deputy Chair of Refugee Council USA and is a member of the Executive Committee of Interaction, the U.S. Council for Voluntary International Action, and has a lot of experience as well with the U.S. Catholic Conference and elsewhere. So welcome to the show, Mitzi.
Thank you, Adam. I'm glad to be on.
Yeah, thank you. I was wondering if you could say something, well, first of all, how you came into this work.
Certainly. I was working in 1979 on a PhD, and it was going slowly, and I was very struck by the Vietnamese boat people crisis, and I suddenly saw all of these people dying at sea and Cambodians being pushed back across borders into minefields. And I said, you know, there are people dying before my eyes. Why should I be working on a report that only two or three people will ever read? And I picked up the phone and began calling agencies working with refugees. And I got a three-month job. And when the 3 months were over, I just kept coming to work. And now somehow it's been 34 years.
Well, time flies.
Yes.
Well, I'm sure you've been busy too. And, you know, within those over 30 years, there have been various crises, different high tides and low tides in the refugee flow. I was wondering how you see it. What has it been like over that period?
Well, speaking in terms of the resettlement of refugees, first of all, which I think was the theme you started with,
mm-hmm.
You know, we've seen a lot of changes in that time. When I first began working in this business, and for many years thereafter, that was during the Cold War, and our refugee resettlement program was really, the thrust of it was to save people from communism. So we were offering refuge to people who had fled from Eastern Europe, fled from the Soviet Union, after the U.S. withdrew from Vietnam, and we did have the boat crisis where people were fleeing from Vietnam and Cambodia. The U.S. felt a special responsibility, as well it should have, for that population.
Your video is not available.
Okay.
Indo-Chinese. So in the early days, the populations were from Eastern Europe, from Russia, from Indochina, and basically and from Cuba. Almost all of the refugees were from a few communist countries. After the Cold War, the program became, in a sense, less political. It became more based on humanitarian need as such, and it became more diversified to meet the needs of a wider number of refugees. So that today, while we're not resettling as many refugees as we were in those early days when the program was really massive, we're resettling refugees from a much wider variety of countries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think perhaps the sense that this is all very political may go back several decades, and so people may still perceive it that way. But in terms of why the numbers are less, why is that? Because we hear that there are so many displaced millions around the world.
Well, I think that, I don't want to defend that policy. First of all, my organization, like a lot of organizations working with refugees, would like to see many more people resettled.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact is, even under the best of circumstances, probably only 1% of the world's refugees will ever be offered resettlement. It's expensive. It's time-consuming. Mm. Not all refugees want to be resettled. The vast majority want to be able to return home in safety and dignity.
Mm-hmm.
And some accept resettlement only very reluctantly. For example, the refugees from Bhutan that the U.S. has been resettling for the last few years, until a few years ago, they were not willing to be resettled, and their host country, Nepal, also was not willing to have them be resettled. It was only after about 16 years in exile that they began to realize that they never would be able to return to Bhutan, that the government there was adamant against taking them back. And so they have agreed to come to the United States and other resettlement countries, and now over 60,000 have come to the U.S. in the last few years. And let me say that that is purely a humanitarian program. The U.S. really has no political reason to resettle those refugees except for their dire need.
Mm-hmm. When I see a lot of people in Queens who seem to be from Nepal, I don't know if they are Bhutanese, actually. I've never asked them. But there seem to be a lot of people from Nepal as well. So as you see different trends of people coming in, whether it's TPS, whether it's asylum or refugees, which are the groups that you see in the last 5 years coming to the United States?
Well, the largest groups in the last few years have been Burmese.
Mm-hmm.
Burmese refugees, quite a few of those have come in the tens of thousands.
Mm-hmm.
Bhutanese, Iraqi refugees, and of course that's as a result of the U.S. Involvement in Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
Somali refugees, because mm-hmm. Somalia is a failed state, and there have been, you know, vast numbers of refugees coming out of Somalia. We continue receiving Cubans. That is a vestige of the Cold War.
Mm-hmm.
Eritreans,
mm-hmm.
Iranians, those are the people with the largest numbers over the last few years.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a new program is just getting started that we're very excited about, that is going to be offering resettlement over the next, say, 5 to 10 years, about 50,000 Congolese.
Mm-hmm.
And they won't all come to the United States. That's the that's the full number that will be resettled. But we do think quite a few will come here. And my organization, Jesuit Refugee Service, works in the Democratic Republic of Congo and works in the countries around the Congo. And we see the tremendous suffering and deprivation that those people have had. So we're very glad to see that at least some people will have this opportunity.
Mm. Well, I have a question about criteria, but first mm-hmm. I just wondered about Syrians,
mm-hmm.
since so many are being dislocated right now as well. I don't believe there's any large number that have come to U.S. yet, though they may be relatives to take care of them. What have you heard about that?
There have not been a large number that have come yet. I think that we will see an increase in the number of Syrians probably in the next year or two. I think that at this point most of the thrust of the effort has been just to receive, house, feed, and take care of those refugees who are coming out.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a very large number of Syrian refugees now, 1.7 million.
Mm-hmm.
have left the country, and there's over 4.25 million who are internally displaced as well.
Mm.
And JRS is working all over the region with those refugees. We're providing education programs, which is one of our areas of specialty, counseling. Inside of Syria, we're providing food and non-food items and education and psychosocial programming for about 100,000 people right now, and we're increasing the numbers we're serving by 5,000 a month, and that's an indication of the, unfortunately, the tremendous growth of need within the country.
Mm. How do you get access to the country? Are you in both government-controlled and less government-controlled
yes,
areas?
Yes, we are. Mm-hmm. Yes, we are. And our regional director is a Syrian Jesuit priest.
Mm.
We have our staff are approximately half Syrian Christians and half Syrian Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have a few, but very few, expatriates working in the country, you know, providing technical assistance and administration. Mm. But basically, we have access because most of our staff are Syrians.
Mm. And I hope the diversity of that staff can be maintained and help with, you know, whatever comes next.
Well, that's a concern. I mean, if this huge, huge, huge cloud has a very, very tiny silver lining, it may be that we're seeing different Christian groups and different Muslim groups who don't normally work together are working together because they're facing a common enemy, which is death and destruction.
Mm. Well, you mentioned the Bhutanese, and I also wanted to ask you about the Rohingya, since right now there is a large number displaced and they're facing ethnic cleansing in Burma. I also understand there isn't a large number yet in the United States. I don't actually know the numbers of refugees outside of Burma. Is JRS working on that issue?
We're working with some Rohingya in Thailand. We are not working in Bangladesh, although we certainly advocate on that issue, and that is my area of expertise. The Rohingya are a minority. You know, Burma is a country of many minorities, and this particular one is a people who are similar to the Bengali people who live in Bangladesh. And many years ago, in 1982, actually, Burma stripped the Rohingya of their citizenship and made them stateless people and began a program of persecution, which continues to this day. And so as a result, many Rohingya went into exile, initially into Bangladesh, but they've also gone into Malaysia and into the Middle East and into many, you know, in smaller numbers, into many countries in the region. And it's one of the most terrible situations of refugee situations on earth. The Bangladeshi government, it's a very poor country. It's slowly sinking into the sea. It has little land or resources to share, and it remains adamant that these people cannot integrate into their society and must return home. The Burma remains just as adamant that they're not their citizens, and they shouldn't be allowed back. And then those Rohingya who have remained in Burma are under constant pressure and, you know, have been, again, displaced by the violence over the last year.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't really know what the solution to this is. There is a program of resettlement for the Rohingya, and small numbers come to the U.S. every year and go to other countries, but it isn't a very large program. I don't want to talk about this too much because I know there are delicate negotiations going on between the governments concerned at this point. I think it's safe to say the U.S. would like to see more Rohingya resettled. They also would like to see other solutions, you know, found for the bulk of the population because it is quite a large group, at least a quarter of a million people in Bangladesh right now.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned that a lot of refugees, in fact, would like repatriation, going back home, and of course, that makes a lot of sense. But if someone comes here, you know, everything else has failed. They were lucky. They got admission to the United States. What kind of benefits do refugees receive that probably other immigrants aren't able to obtain?
Well, there first of all is an initial package of services they get during the first 3 months. That's paid for by the Department of State with also private funding. It's a public-private partnership, and it really is a wonderful model as to how resources from different, the government and the private sector can be put together to do good for people. Basically, they're received, an apartment is provided for them, necessary clothing, food, and so on is provided. A sponsoring organization helps them enroll their children in school, get any paperwork they need done, make sure that they have medical care, and basically, sees to it that they're oriented to the community, helps them get language training if they need that sort of help, and most importantly, helps them find jobs. So that's an initial placement. After that, another organization, the Office of Refugee Resettlement of the Department of Health and Human Services provides a longer grant for a few extra months of services. But compared to other countries who take far fewer resettled refugees, the U.S. program is very Spartan in some senses. It does not provide long-term assistance. Refugees are expected to find work and to become established in a reasonable amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
So it is sort of I won't call it sink or swim, it's not that dire, but it is sort of a total immersion a program where people have to make a real effort to get established quickly.
Well, yeah, I'm not surprised, but yes, it sounds like the partnership is crucial in getting the initial resettlement going. And and is there a way that people can assist refugees later on? I mean, in the different faith-based groups like your own.
Yes, certainly. I think it's 9 resettlement agencies that sponsor refugees. Some of them are faith-based and some of them are secular.
Mm-hmm.
Migration and Refugee Services of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops is the largest organization, and they work through Catholic dioceses and parishes around the country. Other faith-based organizations, the Lutherans, the Episcopalians, and so on, also work through their local parishes to provide hospitality and services to refugees.
Mm-hmm.
And then the secular organizations, which include International Rescue Committee and several others, also work through local institutes or local offices, so they all welcome volunteers.
Hmm. Well, this sounds great. And if people are tired of writing their doctoral theses or their, they can do what you did and throw it up in the air and connect with a life of service. And I really want to thank you very much for what you're doing. And I understand the new Pope Francis is also a Jesuit.
He is.
So I hope that spirit of service will continue to flow out and effectively make the world a better place. So I guess, are there any contact information that listeners should have about your programs?
Yes, if they'd like to learn more about Jesuit Refugee Service, they can visit our website at www.jrsusa.org.
Mm-hmm.
We'd be very happy to, if they did that. There's a lot of information there about our programs and about the refugee program in general. Or they could also visit the website of Refugee Council USA, also a great source of information.
Great. Well, thanks, Mitzi.
Thank you, Adam.
Yeah. Mitzi Schroeder, Director of Policy, Jesuit Refugee Services, USA. We're going to take a quick station break, and we'll be right with you after this.
You are tuned to WBAI in New York and WBAI.org. You are listening to the War on Immigrants Report. Please stay tuned.
Yeah.
This is music from the Rohingya people of Burma, and as we try to find our next guest, who will be, I hope, Sheikh Ubaid, who is on the board of the Burma Muslim Task Force, and also well known for his work with the Muslim Peace Coalition. But we're going to continue playing this music for a little bit and see if we can get Sheikh Ubaid.
Amar de sharpani, kara purayani. Amar de sharpani, kara purayani. Aita mo bur roshere, aghe mo budilam deshe ne sarilam, deshe morilam dukhe dukhe.
And this is the War on Immigrants Report. We're back and 99.5 FM, WBAI Radio. This is Adam Carroll. I work in the Muslim community with the New York State Interfaith Network for Immigration Reform and now with Burma Muslim Task Force USA. And I have a board member of Burma Muslim Task Force USA on the line, Sheikh Ubaid. Welcome to the show and salam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam and thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you. I wanted to ask you some things on air about the work of the task force. But first, to back up a moment, because you're very well known for heading the Muslim Peace Coalition. And so I wanted just to ask you how you came to form that organization, when it was, and what kind of issues you're working on.
We came to form that that coalition. It's a coalition of Muslim organizations and peace activists. And we realized around 2010 that with the growth of Islamophobia here, the peace activists are the only ones who were supporting the Muslims unconditionally. And the Muslims were scared to stand with them because of the prevailing, war hysteria, which was subsiding but was still quite prevalent. So we wanted to educate the Muslims that it is our moral as well as patriotic duty that, this incessant wars, which are not in the interest of humanity or not in the interest of America, we should speak up against it. And we thought that hatred, such as Islamophobia, war, and a falling economy were all interrelated, and we should try to stop all three phenomena.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one thing on your website I like very much. It says, the Muslim Peace Coalition believes that war, terrorism, and Islamophobia form a dangerous nexus that is dragging our nation backward. And I think that's well put. And the different programs and projects of the coalition, I think, include the statement by the 100 New York imams in 2011. I was wondering if you could say something about what that's about.
In that year, there was going to be an anti-war march in Manhattan. Most of the groups that constituted the anti-war movement had become dormant with the election of President Obama. And then they later realized that they need to get active again, and they came together and had formed United National Anti-War Coalition. And they had asked for an anti-war march, and we wanted to get support from the Muslim grassroots. So we approached the imams, who are the community leaders and the religious leaders in the New York, New Jersey area, and we were successful in getting 100 imams to declare their support for this march.
Mm-hmm. So as an organizer and a community leader, you've worked on a number of issues, and also some of them have had to do with oppression, both at home and overseas. One of the projects that I know you've been extremely active on has been the issue of the right-wing Hindu movements that target Muslims in India. I was wondering if you could say something about that.
The right-wing Hindu movement is a supremacist movement that was started after its founders met Mussolini in Italy, and later they started to derive their inspiration from Hitler. And it is a movement that killed Gandhi, the avatar of nonviolence and the father of modern India. They had been involved in multiple programs of both Muslims and Christians in India. And we realized that quite a bit of their funding was coming from the West. Many of their supporters had come to the United States and also Western Europe and were quite affluent. And they had quietly managed to take over many of the organizations of the Indian diaspora because they are so committed and organized.
Mm-hmm.
In 2002, immediately after 9/11, this organization, this Hindutva movement, in the western state of Gujarat, conducted a pogrom in which more than 2,000 Muslims were killed and more than 500 women were raped and then hacked to death.
Hmm.
And the leader of that movement was planning to become the next Prime Minister of India. And so we formed a coalition here, very broad-based, 43 different community organizations of all faiths. And in 2005, we managed to stop him from running for that post in his party, primary. Because his diplomatic visa to the U.S. was canceled.
Mm-hmm.
And we have been involved in increasing awareness because it is the fastest growing hate group in the United States because of so many of supporters and followers of Hindutva coming to the U.S. every year.
Mm-hmm. Now, is the Hindutva, is that the name of the movement?
Yeah. Hindutva. It's completely different from the Hindu religion.
Mm-hmm.
And they kill Gandhi, they will go after moderate Hindus and they will go after anybody who stands in their way.
Mm. And now, there are plenty of Islamophobic movements and a lot of Islamophobia in the United States. Is there any link between Indian anti-Muslim groups and these Western groups?
I'm so glad that you brought that up. If you go to the websites which are quite notorious for Islamophobia in the U.S. run by people like Pamela Geller and others, you will see a growing link between American-born Islamophobes and this recent Hindutva immigrants. And if you go to the various news stories, any story on Muslims or Islam, you go to the comments section and you see all these comments full of hatred and vitriol. And many of the names are, from Hindutva. As we watch these groups, we can very clearly identify them, and they have been working very closely. If you Google names such as Pamela Geller and Babu Susilan, for example, who said that Muslims are multiplying like cockroaches in the U.S., and he was sharing the stage with Geller and Robert Spencer.
Mm-hmm. Well, very troubling. And the anti-Muslim movement has deep pockets and is apparently coordinated internationally in some respects. So it's in a nation as big as India, it's troubling that it's linked, that there are these links between movements. But the other anti-Muslim movements that there have been, one thinks, of course, of the Rohingya, the experience, the extremist Buddhist groups, which surprises people because we think of Buddhism as connected to nonviolence, and but there are nationalist Buddhist groups in Burma that are now targeting Muslims and spreading the same kind of rhetoric that dehumanizes the Muslim population. As we started speaking about the Rohingya, though, I wanted to also mention that my understanding is that the Burma Muslim Task Force is in some ways based on an earlier model having to do with Bosnia. Were you involved with the Bosnia project?
Yeah, I was. I was involved with the Bosnia Task Force in that terrible genocide that took place in the heart of Europe. Mm-hmm. American Muslims had come together and formed a coalition called Burma Task Force, and we worked very closely with human rights groups and other similar mm-hmm. groups, including the National Organization of Women, because if you remember, in taking the cue from Kashmir, where rape was used as a weapon to demoralize, Serbians had set up these rape camps where Muslim women were being gang raped on a daily basis in thousands. And we were able to successfully lobby the Congress to get rape declared as a war crime.
Mm-hmm.
And that model we started to use for the Burma Task Force, as you said.
Hmm. Well, you and I as Muslims know that, you know, oppression of anyone, not just Muslims, is something that we oppose and we work to address. But unfortunately, it's also true that many of the groups that have been targeted have been Muslims, both in wars, which might be Muslim against Muslim, but also in other situations where Muslims are the minority and are vulnerable. So with the Rohingya, we were discussing with the previous guest a little bit. This is a minority group that has been for centuries in Burma or Myanmar, which is a country now emerging from a long period of being quite close to the outside world, being under a military dictatorship. So it's a delicate moment with the desire for greater democracy and public participation, but at the same time with these quite cruel and exclusionary laws. So who are the Rohingya? How would you put it?
Rohingya are Bengali-speaking people of Burmese descent. Burma is a very interesting place. If you go by the movement of the Homo sapiens species, you have the modern human being coming out of Africa. And, some say they came, they entered Asia towards the north along Sinai. But some others say that they entered Asia through Yemen anyway. And then there were two branches. One went to Central Asia and China. And have more of a features of the Mongolian and Chinese people. And then the other came to India, which later mixed with the Aryans when they invaded India. So anyway, these two big groups, again, started to meet in Burma, which is the juncture of South Asia and Southeast Asia. So Burma is a very complex place where you have multiple ethnicities. And one of the ethnicities was Rohingya, who had their own separate kingdom. And they had been living in that area for centuries, even millennia. And they had a separate kingdom till 1784, when the Burmese Buddhist kingdom conquered it and annexed it. But by 1820s, a British, after having conquered India, went into Burma and annexed Burma. And if you look at the census on 1850s and 1860s in Burma and done under British, in Arakan state, where Rohingyas are, they constituted more than 30% of the population. Now that state is called Rakhine, and they constitute less than 5%.
Yeah. And
as you know.
Yeah, and some of the government policies have certainly tried to marginalize this population. And I was wondering if you could list them. I mean, of course, there's a limit on how many children, and there's interfaith marriage ban. There's a number of things. I was wondering if you could sort of encapsulate some of these.
Yeah, not only interfaith marriage ban, there is a sort of a marriage ban. Starting around 1960s, when the military took over, they started a divide and rule policy, and already there was some hatred against people who came from India and the British, and they were running the businesses as well as the bureaucracy. So that anti-Indian hatred was turned into anti-Rohingya hatred, and the military played this card well. And around 1980s, the Rohingyas were deprived of their citizenship. So they cannot marry because they cannot go and register for the marriage because they don't have the citizenship papers. And every few years, there would be flare-up of pogroms and ethnic cleansing, and hundreds of thousands of them would be pushed into, at one time, East Pakistan and now Bangladesh. And after Bangladesh has closed its borders, they take on these very fragile boats and go into the Bay of Bengal and Indian Ocean, and many of them drown, trying to escape to distant lands. So there are more Rohingyas living outside Burma than living in Burma, in Bangladesh and also in Pakistan. And quite a few of them actually live in Saudi Arabia because in the 60s, the king of Saudi Arabia, King Faisal, opened its doors and allowed a huge number of them to come there.
Well, more recently, though, there have been an increase in village burnings and murders. And in some of the, I understand there are photographs of the 48 school children who tried to seek sanctuary with some Buddhist groups. And in the end, the crowd got them and burned them to death. And there are also tragedies with people drowning or being at sea as refugees for 4 or 5 months. So there's a lot of suffering out there. I was wondering what you see the role of people of goodwill around the world, how we can address this humanitarian crisis.
The anti-Muslim and anti-foreign hatred permeates into the Burmese psyche very deeply because for the last many decades, the school children were taught a dehumanized version that is darker skin, Rohingyas are not even humans. Just like in Deep South when people were comfortable watching lynching. So unless there is a sustained pressure from the international community, for the long run, the sustained pressure to start teaching that all human beings are equal and also making sure that Burmas enact laws which protect all ethnic groups, including Rohingyas. But at the short term, we have to make sure that the ethnic cleansing stops, that the foreign media as well as the foreign human rights and relief organizations are allowed to come into Burma. And then, Burma, which is now opening up to the world, provides us a very good opportunity. Earlier, it was close to the world like North Korea, and it was playing India against China, and those two countries were giving full unconditional support to the Burmese government. It is now trying to do that by playing China against the U.S. So we should put pressure on our our government that any investment, any business should be linked to human rights. Because if Burma gets destabilized, see, Burma is surrounded by so many Muslim countries.
Mm-hmm.
And sooner or later, you know, the sparks might reach other countries, and that's a very crucial area. And the U.S. is now focusing more on Pacific towards its foreign policy. And you cannot get, you know, Malaysia and Indonesia get embroiled into this.
Mm-hmm.
So we must make sure that our government puts pressure on the Burmese government to ensure human rights and equal treatment for Rohingyas. And mm-hmm. this ethnic cleansing should come to a stop right away.
Yeah, unfortunately, the U.S. is losing some of its credibility on human rights issues, but still, I think we should all support that being part of our foreign policy and messaging. The dehumanization that you mentioned is a long-term problem. It was good to hear that a group of an international group of Buddhist leaders met in Thailand and crafted a statement, and that the Dalai Lama has also made statements to the extremist Buddhist leaders in Burma, but so far they're not listening because it's a different sect within the religion. So whether it's the Save Darfur model or other models of action that we need to adopt, some of us are going to be working on this, and I wanted to encourage the listeners to contact me and see how we can help raise awareness and take action. You can use my email, adem@burmamuslims.org. That's adem@burmamuslims.org, and I'm definitely respond to you. I think there's a lot of suffering to address, and as we were saying before, there aren't many Rohingyas here, but perhaps next time we weren't able to have another speaker, Aisha Wahid, who's affiliated with your projects, Sheikh Ubaid. I understand there's a death in her family, and we're sorry for her loss. But hopefully on the next show, we will follow up a bit on this issue. We're going to wrap up the show now. So thank you for Sheikh Ubaid for being on the show. And the website is www.burmamuslims.org. I just wanted to mention along the subject of freedom, this Monday will be the International Day of Action for the Prisoner Hunger Strikes in Pelican Bay, and also the Ural Selik Orthodox Jewish Social Justice Group will be giving voice to torture victims in U.S. prisons, 12:30 to 2 p.m. That is on Monday, the 8th of July, Times Square, corner 41st and Broadway, near the tickets booth. Good work, and we will wrap up now just saying that Frederick Douglass, in his comments on the 4th of July, what to the slave is the 4th of July, 1852, said that there is consolation in the thought that America is young. Great streams are not easily turned from channels. So are we still young? Are we as young as Egypt? Do we need to be? We'll go out with this music, and I hope that we can find some hope in the coming year. Happy birthday to all.
You're tuned to WBAI in New York. In the preceding program, the War on Immigrants Report was brought to you live with certain portions on digital delay. Again, as I say, you're tuned to WBAI, New York. And